Lumberjacks is sponsored by Echo, only professional grade with 5-year warranty. Crown, protect, maintain, save. Dickies, quality workwear since 1922. Yamaha, rev your heart.
Back here in Truro, Nova Scotia for the exciting conclusion of the Nova Scotia Professional Lumberjack Championships. We got 30 competitors vying for $6,000 in prize money, and we got a leaderboard chock full of great competitors. Hi, I'm Bill Debo with my co-host and Lumberjack sport analyst, Rod Cumberland. Rod, we're going to end things off with a couple of exciting events, the kettle boil and the hot saw.
Hot saw event is getting more and more exciting all the time. Guys are building bigger and faster saws. Miro Bork has a new saw built by Gaston Dupre, and Don Lambert, the Rico man, has his favorite saw here as well.
Now, Lumberjack Sports is mostly about individual skilled competitions. We have a few doubles events, one this week, and it's called the Kettle Boil. Teams of two working towards the same goal.
Yeah, and quite fitting here in Rick Russell's town, Truro, Nova Scotia, that we're doing it here. And two of his protege, Scott Reed and Mario Bork, are probably going to be the guys to beat in that event.
You know, I've been to Truro a number of times over the years, and it's always related to Lumberjack Sports. Back in the 80s when I was a competitor and then a coach at Fleming College, we used to come here every February for an indoor competition, a woodsman competition, at the agricultural campus of Dalhousie University. Back in those days, Rick Russell was a competitor and a coach, and he basically built the program. Well, Rick passed away from cancer a number of years ago, but they still, in his memory, have a competition in February. It's called the Rick Russell Memorial Woodsman Competition, and I know he had a big impact in your life as well, Rod.
Rick was a great friend. Of course, we organized the first East-West Challenge between Eastern competitors and Western competitors in Marble Mountain, Newfoundland, back in 2001. So yeah, Rick was a great guy, ran a lot of shows here in the province, and of course, all these young people are all a result of Rick's efforts.
Now, the statue we're looking here at downtown Truro is not a statue of Rick Russell, but they could have a statue of Rick Russell, maybe on the campus of AC one day. Here's the overall standings heading into the final stretch of the competition. Nathan Cumberland leading the way, hot on his heels as Marcel Dupuis, only 15 points behind as we head into the underhand chop. Now, this is an event that Nathan is going to take on Marcel Dupuis and Ben Cumberland, and Nathan's really going to want to win this one to extend his lead.
Well, in this first heat, we're going to watch Trevor Schofield taking on Berlin Nickerson. And, of course, we've seen these guys battling out in the last two Axe events. One win apiece for these guys, so it's a real grudge match here in the underhand chop. A
lot of things in common for Berlin and Trevor. They're both Maritimers, both spent some time out in British Columbia honing their lumberjack skills, and now they're here they are back in Eastern Canada raising a family, still involved in the sport.
Well, we saw Berlin Nickerson take first place in the heat between he and Trevor in the springboard chop, and then in the standing block chop, Trevor Schofield took down Berlin, and Berlin makes a first switch to side number two, so he's got a bit of a jump right now on Trevor Schofield.
Well, he made his turnover to the backside first, but I don't think he's going to be happy with the front side. It was a mess. Trevor Schofield staying with him, stroke for stroke. A miss hit there for Berlin's going to cost him, and Trevor Schofield wins the first heat of the underhand chop in just over 33 seconds. Berlin's not going to be happy with that.
You said you had been laying off the axe for a while, but the pace you were going at was pretty good. I mean, I counted, and you did a lot of your homework on the front side. I counted 20 swings of the axe on your front side. So you win it in the front, don't you?
I wasn't counting, but I tried to do my homework on the front and didn't want to get wooded on the back or anything. So, yeah, I've been out of the sport for 7 years. This is my first show in 7 years. So a little rusty, but trying to hit the gym and stay in shape.
Yeah, exactly. You rely on your experience. I mean, you know how to do it. And if you're a good cardio and you're in shape, you can pick up the pace like you did.
Yeah, it's kind of like riding a bike. It comes back pretty quick, so.
Well, if your technique's not going to be that good and you're going to miss a lot of hits, maybe you can make up for it by going really, really fast. And that's what Trevor did. Now, technique and speed is going to be the ultimate, along with accuracy. Trevor's going to be in the mix, but I think we got a couple of choppers here that might take him down, including Ben Cumberland and Nick Graham in this heat.
Well, they're chopping 12 inches of round aspen in this event. And, of course, if they've watched Ben and Nathan Cumberland chop, they know that once they get started, they're just like a house on fire. So they're going to need a little bit faster pace than what they normally might have.
Looks like the aspen here is nice and clean. It's a little bit firm there. And Ben Cumberland's opening up a lot of wood in the front side here. Puts his drivers in, makes a nice turn over to the backside. He's ahead of Nick at this point.
The other thing, of course, that you never factor in is these guys all draw for the wood before you start. So, of course, some guys get nice blocks, some guys get hard blocks. Ben's got a decent block, and his axe is chopping it nice. He's doing a good job here as he drives it off and lowers the time to beat to 25.7.
Looks like a good technical chop there by Ben Cumberland.
Okay, I'm good at counting. I counted 12 strokes in the front, 13 in the back. Just tell me about your last couple on the front side. You're cleaning out the bottom, aren't you?
Yeah, the last two on the bottom, one on the chip, one on the drive. Chip just to clear the bottom wood, because usually in the front, that's the wood you miss. So just clear it out so it comes off a little bit easier in the back.
So on your backside, did it come off when you expected it to come off with those drivers? You took 13 strokes. Ideally, you would, of course, like to have taken less, but, you know, maybe 12 or 11. Did it come off when it wanted you to come off?
For the most part, I mean, when I put my footholds in, the wood felt pretty tough. So I was just trying to aim to follow my lines and cut it in as few strokes as possible. But, yes, fewer strokes is better. But I'm happy with the cut.
Well, pretty good decision there by Ben Cumberland. He made a decision to make one more stroke on the right side, which is chip side, before he did his final drivers. A good job there by Ben, lowering the time to beat down to 25.78. Here is our feature heat right now. Guys who have been battling it out throughout the competition. Nathan Cumberland taking on Marcel Dupuy.
Marcel Dupuy, the Canadian champ in the underhand chop. Of course, he actually holds a Canadian record right now. His block is slabbing off here, so he knows he's got a good stick of wood. And Nathan makes a change to the first side just ahead of him.
Marcel's block is split. Look at the pace by Nathan as he wants to beat Marcel really bad. And the foothold comes apart from Marcel. It's going to be tough for balance. Cumberland bringing some drivers in. And Cumberland wins the underhand chop with a 19.7, just edging out Marcel Dupuy. In an earlier heat, we saw your brother Ben do 12 and 13. You did 10 and 12, 22 strokes.
Yep.
Is that due to strength or accuracy? Tell me about it.
Probably more just to a better block. Ben and I are always hit and miss when it comes to chopping, and typically it comes down to the block. So I'd anticipated 10 hits on the front, and to be honest, I just kind of lost myself in the chop. I just got going and didn't really think, so 10 was good, and 12 on the back to bring it off was decent. So
we talked about strength and accuracy. Just tell me about your speed. I mean, your speed seems to be getting better and better all the time, because that's the third one to come, really, is, you know, picking up the pace and making it fast.
Yeah, I've typically hit almost too fast sometimes. It would probably almost benefit me more if I was to slow down a little bit, hit a little harder and more accurate, because when you get going so fast, you lose your accuracy and you sacrifice your speed quite a bit. So,
thanks for your time.
You're welcome.
Well, Nate won't be too happy with how pretty that chop looks, but it was very effective, giving him first place in the underhand chop. George Williams in an earlier heat finished with a 31.9, giving him fourth place.
We're working in the parking lot here of the Cat Shack, and the owner is Paul Blankhorn.
We are the Cat Shack in Truro, Nova Scotia. We are a Suzuki, Yamaha, and Articat dealer, centrally located, just an hour from Halifax, 45 minutes from Anticonish. It's very important to be involved in this because it's our customers. Our customers buy the chainsaws, our customers use the chainsaws, our customers use the motorcycles, the ATVs. It's very important. It's actually enjoyable watching them use all the equipment that we sell.
Well, we're heading into the women's stock saw. Earlier, we saw the men's stock saw. This is the women's, two cuts within 4 inches. We're gonna be showing you the top three heats. This is Jesse Swinemer taking on Kyla Graham. We saw them earlier in the single buck. So Jesse is looking for a little bit of revenge over Kyla.
Well, they'll be running Echo CS 620 chainsaws here in this 13 inches of poplar. They've all been packed to 13,500 RPM exactly. So it all comes down to the operator.
And one of the keys to success in the stock saw is getting to the wood quickly. And Kyla did exactly that. She was at the wood well ahead of Jesse. A little bit of struggle at the end, but Kyla wins the first heat of the stock saw at 12.6.
So a great cut there by Kayla Graham in this first heat.
So Kaylee had a great cut going there. What happened towards the end? You want to tell us about it?
Coming up on the second cookie, I just bogged up a little bit, put too much pressure on the chain. So, yeah, could have gone a little better.
Okay, so do you do much practicing at the stock saw?
Yeah, I do. It's one of my weaker events, so yeah. Okay.
Do you practice with that same saw?
With an Echo, yep.
Yeah, okay, great.
Yep.
Well, you can see at the end there, both competitors struggled at the very end. Sometimes they're a little bit too anxious to get the cuts complete. A little bit too much pressure on the saw bogs them down, costs them a second. And in the game of stock saw, that's going to cost you some money. This next heat, Caitlin Carroll taking on Kelly Bonus.
Well, as the wood gets smaller at the top, sometimes competitors will try to rush that off. It gives them a little bit of an advantage if it comes off. But if it doesn't, you'll bog the saw down as Kelly Bonus gets into all kinds of trouble here in her second cut. Does not get a starter, it has to go back. And look at Caitlin Carroll come from behind. It's gonna be a photo finish here, but I think Kelly Bonus is gonna squeeze her out.
Kelly had a really ripping cut going there, and then things slowed down the second cut. Tell us about it.
Yeah, I was coming up my second cut, and it felt like it was pretty easy to get the saw moving up through it, so I decided to take a look, and my bar was partially out, so I had to restart the second cut.
Right on. So how's that going to affect you for the overall?
Probably won't win the overall, but you never know. It takes longer to do that, so.
Right on. So do you spend much time practicing stock saw?
No.
So what are you going to do when you go home?
I'm going to practice stock saw.
Atta girl, Kelly. Good cut. Thanks a lot.
Well, typically a competitor will notice that they're out of the cut a little bit earlier than that. She was about one-third of the way through the cut there before she noticed that her bar wasn't completely buried. She easily could have had a couple of seconds off that time and been in the 12-second range. As it stands right now, Kyla Graham is still leading the way with 12.69. Heading into our last heat, Melanie Burke taking on Janet Walker.
Well, Janet Walker loves a stock saw event. It's her signature event here. But look on the right-hand side of the screen. Melanie Burke, the first one getting her cookie down. Melanie's putting the power right to it, and she blows things away here in the ladies' stock saw event with a time of 11.07 seconds.
So, Melanie, I noticed you hesitate just a little bit before you hit the block. You want to tell them what you're doing there?
Well, it's not the best thing to be doing, but when I pick up my saw, I'm forever setting it in crooked and not putting it where I want it to be, and I end up cutting my line and missing my cut altogether. So I just take the second to line up my first cookie where I want it so that I end up getting a cut.
Well, that was a great cut.
Thank you.
Well, we talked about the Burks earlier. We saw Mario and the Axe Throw doing quite well. Well, here's Melanie doing even better, winning the women's stock saw with 11.07, taking out the field.
Closed captioning is brought to you by 1867 Confederation Log and Timber Frame, Canada's leader in log and timber frame homes since 1979. This is Living.
A beautiful campus, formerly known as the Nova Scotia Agricultural College, now is the agricultural campus of Dalhousie University in Halifax. Great competition here. We've been hitting the hot saw, one of the favorites of all the competitors and the spectators. We got the Rico man on the left-hand side, also known as Donald Lambert from Saint-Gilles, Quebec, taking on Berlin Nickerson. I know there's something special about his saw.
Berlin Nickerson is wielding 375 cc's of power in this new saw built by Ken Hiltz from Nova Scotia, and he's going to be taking on the Rico man from Saint-Gilles, Quebec. He'll have his hands full.
Well, Donald Lambert typically runs 250 cc's motorcycle engine. Look at the speed on Donald getting to the wood. Berlin struggling in the right-hand side there. Donald wins the first heat with 3.88, and Berlin comes in with 7.18. So we have 12 inches of wood here today, and we've got some big saws. Just tell me about when you're running a big saw, 12 inches of wood, it's a little bit more challenging because you spend a lot of time in the air as opposed to in the wood.
Well, transfer is very important, so you have to start. So I missed a little bit my trigger at the beginning, my first cut, and it cost me some time. But overall, you cannot miss the transfer in between each cut.
Would you rather see 18 inches of wood or would you rather see 12 inches of wood?
18 inches is better because you have time to see, you have time to play with the cut, you have time to see how it's going to go. And for smaller saws, it's more challenging.
Certainly more challenging. Small wood, like 12 inches, there is zero room for error. You got a lot of great hot sawyers here. 3.88 is a great time, but a small mistake by Donald there may cost him a tenth or two, and that is a beatable time, believe it or not.
Well, there's a little bit of room there, but boys, his transition between his three cuts were really good, so there's not a whole lot of time. As both these guys' saws get going, Marcel's running a brand new saw by Ken Hiltz, Mario Bork running a saw that's just been rebuilt by Gaston Duperey, and it's going to come right down to the watch as who wins this.
Well, I guess it's got to make you a little bit nervous when you have a hard time starting it in the warm-up.
Absolutely. Like, this saw is Kent Hill's saw. I was just using it today, and then I couldn't get it going, so then I knew I was running out of time. So I'm like, oh, I'm going to put it together, and hopefully she goes. And she went, so can't complain. The saw is a really good saw. So
I was talking to Ken before the show, and he was telling me it's 370 cc's, about 97 horsepower.
Yeah, that's what he's saying. So that's a whole bunch of power to have in your hands.
Well, it was a good job. A little bit nerve-wracking in the beginning, but good job.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, we talk about margin for error. I think Mario may have had a winning saw there, but he hesitated and cost him a second or two. He comes in with a 5.38. Marcel takes him down with a 5.12. Both these guys, Woodland and Reed, they could take down Donald's time of 3.88. Both of them expert sawyers.
Paul Woodland, we know, is a world record holder in the hot saw. Scott Reed's building these saws now, so both guys capable. Oh, look at that. Scott Reed throws a chain as Paul Woodland rips three off, and he wins by 4/100ths of a second.
And some tough luck for Scott Reed there, throwing a chain. Well, we haven't got official times yet. That's going to be a pretty tough time to beat, but you're still not quite happy with your start?
No, I kind of got the saw too high over the wood and took quite a thick cookie there on the start.
Which is going to cost you maybe a hundredth of a second, maybe a tenth of a second. What do you think?
Oh, 0.2 for sure. Yeah, if the crowd can see it, it's 0.2.
But other than that, you know, a big saw like that and 12 inches of wood, is that something you prefer? Or would you rather see, you know, 16, 18, 20 inches?
No, 8x8 and up is good enough with me.
Well, we had some kind of a dogfight for first place in the hot saw. Don Lambert, with that little bit of a glitch at the start, cost him first place as Paul Wooden lays down a 3.84 to take it.
Well, we're going to put a bow on the first annual Nova Scotia Lumberjack Championships. There's Ryan McIntyre getting the stage ready to go. We're heading into the water boil, and typically most lumberjack competitions end with the hot saw and end with the water boil. Here we are. The sun is setting in Truro, Nova Scotia, and it's going to be an intense battle here. We got a lot of experienced competitors here in the water boil and a lot of guys who have won events before. And, Rod, well, you're one of the experts. I know you trained the Cumberland boys. What do you got to say about that?
Well, it's going to be a great race here because we know we have Mario Bork teamed up with Scott Reed. We see them right here. They're a great kettle boil pair when it comes to this event. They'll be taking on the likes of Marcel Dupuis, Paul Woodland, the Cumberland boys. And again, in a doubles boil, things happen a whole lot faster. So rather than seeing a three-minute time, we're going to see something between just over 2 minutes.
Well, basically, you've got four hands working instead of two hands in the doubles event. And right away, I mean, within 5 seconds, we got the match lead here by Paul Woodland working with Marcel Dupuis. Marcel Dupuis is a fireman. He knows all about fires and the way they work, basically. Mario and Scott have done this many times over and won a lot of times. I see they got a bed of rocks underneath their shavings there. What's the deal with that?
Well, they're actually boiling here on asphalt, so you don't really need that, but sometimes it's nice to have those rocks here actually to get your matches started. So there's not a lot here on the pavement to get things going with your matches, so having those rocks here gives you some place to start. A lot of these guys, of course, have the fires going fairly quickly. You see Paul and them putting some big sticks across. Now, if the wood's really dry, it changes how you build your fire. Rather than putting little small pencils underneath your kettle that'll burn through a lot quicker, you want to have bigger sticks like Paul and Marcel are doing here, and I think that's going to pay off for them in the long run because their kettle won't boil through or burn through and actually fall down into the shavings.
Now, Ryan McIntyre and Dave Patrickin, they were getting some real small pencils. They could be in jeopardy of actually burning the base out because the real small ones, they're going to burn out. You see Paul and Marcel, they're building all the way around the can.
And Paul, you see here, Ben and Nathan's fire also have big sticks underneath. That's a smart move on their behalf. But the guys are almost built up around the outside of the can now. So this is going to come down to the blowing on the can to see who gets this thing done in record time.
And certainly one of the keys, Rod, you've talked about it over the years, is being able to identify the dryness of the wood. Or is it damp wood? Is it dry wood? And of course, if it's dry wood, you talked about it, you get bigger faster.
That's right. It changes the strategy. The other thing here today, of course, we have a lot of wind. So the competitors need to actually play with that, make sure if there's wind coming. You see this fire here blowing right to the other side of the can. They want to put their uprights or their shakes on the side that the wind's coming from to pull that flame back and around the kettle, keep the heat contained so that it actually goes into boiling the kettle.
Well, it's not necessarily a good thing to be able to see a lot of yellow flame escaping, trying to contain it as much as possible. The Cumberland boys have got a great fire here, but they've got a lot of heat escaping. A lot of fire is all over the place.
Does two things, Bill. Number one, you can't get close to blowing it. Number two, of course, you're not containing the heat in tight. See, the guys don't even know what to do. They got to stay way back because they can't get close to blow on it.
Could cost them a couple seconds in the end. Here's the team of McIntyre and Armsworthy. They got a good contained fire, but they may not have got there fast enough.
Well, the problem right now is, of course, Bill, there's a lot of heat here. Some of the guys can't get close enough to it. Sometimes you got to sit back and actually just let it burn.
It's going to be a photo finish here. All three teams are, and there it is, Woodland and Dupuis. Bang, bang, bang. Reed and Burke, Cumberland. 1-2-3 finish.
Wow, what a great race here in the kettle boil right down to the wire.
A couple of years ago, we interviewed you guys for water boil winners, and you wouldn't deliver any secrets to camera. So we're not letting you get away with that this year. I need to know, what you guys are pretty good at this. It was a pretty good field of competitors. Give me a couple of your tips.
All I can tell you, this guy's a firefighter and he knows how a fire works.
Okay, so I'm 0-1 on that one. Marcel, I need a couple of tips for the audience that are watching. What are some of your tips in water boil?
Well, you do some shavings and you light it and then you stack all the way up to the can and then you hope for the best.
Over two.
Okay, we'll have to watch it on video and figure it out for ourselves.
Yes, you will.
Thank you.
See you, boys. Well, not divulging any of their secrets, Woodland and Dupuis win it, but nice to see Caitlin Carroll and Melanie Bork finishing in the top five of the water boil in a very talented field of competitors.
And the crown pivotal point today focuses on Nathan Cumberland in the race for the overall winner here today in Truro. And of course, he takes a third place in Waterboil, doesn't even show up in the hot saw, and that's going to cost him in the overall.
Well, in the end game there, it did cost him in the overall. It came in second place with 500 points, Woodland 200 points behind it. So really, it was only a two-horse race.
So the lumberjack of the day today is Marcel Dupuy from Memram Cook, New Brunswick. He wins the first ever Nova Scotia Lumberjack Championships with 535 points.
We've had this conversation before, of course, Marcel, and once again, you won the lumberjack of the day, overall winner. And once again, a strong field of competitors here in the Maritimes. But, you know, there's a lot of good competitors. Just tell me how you stay on top of them all.
Well, like you've seen today, like, you don't have to win every event to become the overall. You just got to be consistent. And I think that's my name in the game. Like, I got beaten a lot of events today, but I did well at every event. So, at the end of the day, ended up all adding up to be a very good day.
So is it all about, like, minimizing your mistakes, trying to make as few mistakes as possible?
Absolutely. Like, you can only cut your block as good as you can cut it. Like, if you're trying to do something extraordinary every time that you go and compete, you're probably going to cut yourself short a few times. So you just do as best as you can with the block that you have.
Merci beaucoup.
Bienvenue.
Well, hats off to all the businesses and organizations that contributed to today's show and making the first ever Nova Scotia Lumberjack Championships a reality.
What a fantastic show here in Truro, Nova Scotia. Hopefully it becomes an annual event.
Yeah, Ryan McIntyre and his UNB alumni did a great job. There was a great depth of field here as far as competition. Huge crowd. It was awesome.
Come back again next time when it'll be time for Lumberjacks.
Lumberjacks is sponsored by Echo, only professional grade with 5-year warranty. Crown, protect, maintain, save. Dickies, quality workwear since 1922. Yamaha, rev your heart.
Lumberjack competitions are all about providing awesome entertainment for you, the spectator. And when we have live crowds, we want to get all that action up in the air so everyone can see what's going on. So what we do to accomplish that is we actually build a stage. Stages are built out of 2x8 construction typically, and they're built in sections, 8-foot by 12-foot sections, so that they're actually mobile and that we can move them from one show to another. We then bring them here and bolt them together, use 6x6 or 8x8 to get them 2 to 3 feet up in the air so everyone can see what's going on. And once it's good and solid, we then take our metal stanchions that they use to hold the wood for the different events, and we lag screw them to the deck. And of course, it keeps everything good and firm when the competitors are using them.